It was a huge explosion.
Tragedy on the water.
Shook the entire house like an earthquake. You go, oh no, boat's on fire.
An explosion at Horsetooth Reservoir on a busy boating weekend. Now a safety warning from other boaters. Plus, CSU football under fire. New accusations of racism and verbal abuse and how players are now responding.
Hot, dry weather across Colorado. When will finally see some relief from the heat?
Developing news tonight, relief for millions of Americans struggling during this pandemic. President Trump just signed 4 executive orders this afternoon after negotiations in Congress for a new relief package failed. One of the president's orders extends an expired unemployment benefit, giving Americans an extra $400 a week. The original benefit was $600. It expired last month. The executive orders also defer payroll taxes and student loans and extend an eviction moratorium. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm Jacqueline Allen. In a hot summer when COVID has limited our outdoor options, more people are heading to Colorado's reservoirs. And tonight, a tragic accident on Larimer County waters. 6 people hurt after a boat burst into flames on Horsetooth Reservoir. Denver 7's Sloan Dickey talked to people on the water when it happened about the safety warning tonight for boaters.
This is what's left of a speedboat that exploded around 9 a.m. here at Horsetooth Reservoir. Boaters were just heading out on the water when these flames sent 4 people to the hospital.
We heard this huge explosion and we thought, didn't know what it was.
First, an explosion.
And it shook the entire house.
Then the fire.
Just saw a bunch of black smoke.
Witnesses at Horsetooth Reservoir capturing the horrifying moments after a speedboat erupted into flames.
Then I ran in and got my camera. Started shooting pictures.
Boaters capturing the damage up close.
So it was engulfed in flames. They were giving medical attention to some people at the marina on the dock.
Rescue officials with Poter Fire say 6 people were on board when the speedboat leaving the marina exploded. 4 were taken to the hospital, 1 by helicopter.
So it can be pretty dangerous out there.
Boaters telling Denver 7 the smallest mistake can have massive consequences.
Once you get out on the lake too, to check, make sure there's no fuel leaks, anything that you see that's, you know, gonna cause any harm like that.
Safety especially important this year as record numbers of people hit the water.
Every time we bring family or friends, anyone out, it's safety first.
We're still waiting to hear back on those 4 individuals who were sent to the hospital, but officials tell me this is another example of the need to wear a life jacket and to be safe on the water. Reporting in Larimer County, Sloan Dickey, Denver 7.
All right, thanks, Sloan. And the Poudre Fire Department is investigating what caused that boat to catch on fire. High temperatures, low humidity, and strong winds have been a dangerous combination for the Pine Gulch fire. It has grown by more than 7,000 acres in the past 24 hours. That fire is now burning more than 20,000 acres near Grand Junction. More than 450 firefighters are now fighting the fire that sparked last Friday from a lightning strike. There are no evacuations, but there are a few road closures in that area. Temperatures across the Front Range reaching well into the 90s today, but that doesn't stop Coloradans from enjoying the outdoors. Here we found people in Wash Park playing volleyball, basketball, or just out for a nice stroll. Meteorologist Stacy Donaldson joins us now. Stacy, we'll take recommendations for beating the heat because I don't know about, are we going to get any relief anytime soon?
Well, it looks like there's a smidge coming our way in the next couple of days, but for this afternoon, it's still been a beautiful day, although a little on the hot side. We have partly cloudy skies out there now, especially in Westminster, as you see from our Westin camera on the top of the Westin there. Our highs this afternoon have been in the mid to upper 90s here for the Denver area, upper 90s for the Burlington region, and then triple digits down toward La Junta, even 95 for Grand Junction, with 70s and 80s for the higher elevations. We do have an air quality warning in effect through tomorrow afternoon and evening here from Fort Collins to Denver, and another air quality warning tonight through early tomorrow for the Grand Junction area. So we're watching these places carefully, but we really haven't seen much rain that would help us out. We do still have some scattered showers off to our east, but here in Denver, it has been dry and will remain dry through the rest of this evening. Few light showers here just across the eastern plains. It's a little more severe just outside the border of Colorado into Kansas and Nebraska. So we're going to keep a close eye on those storms as they move on out. But otherwise, a hot day here. We'll talk about when that relief will show up in a few minutes.
Looking forward to that. Thanks, Stacey. So how hot and dry is it? It's so dry, the boat ramp at Bar Lake State Park in Brighton will likely close after this weekend because of the dry conditions. Boating has also been suspended at Prewitt Reservoir in northeastern Colorado, and this is the first time in 8 years that the entire state is under drought conditions. In Colorado, the state is reporting more than 430 new coronavirus cases today. That brings the total number of cases to more than 50,000. And here's how Colorado's hospital system is doing right now. You can see close to 350 people are using Colorado hospital beds. That is up by almost 30 people from just yesterday. The pandemic isn't stopping thousands of people from attending the Sturgis rally in South Dakota this weekend. This is a live picture from Sturgis where you can see dozens at least of motorcycles lining the street. The Sturgis rally is likely one of the largest gatherings in the country since the pandemic began. The motorcycle rally ends a week from Sunday. Coronavirus hospitalizations and deaths are on the rise in more than half of the country. That's causing some states to pause reopening plans. Alex Brochet reports on what states are doing to try to keep people safe and what health officials are saying about a vaccine.
The United States quickly approaching a grim milestone of 5 million cases of coronavirus. The nation marking 2,000 more deaths in a 24-hour period for the first time since May. California now passing 10,000 deaths. And in Georgia, a heartbreaking loss. A 7-year-old African-American boy with no underlying conditions dying from the virus. A CDC report finding staggering racial disparities among children. The data showing black children with COVID-19 were hospitalized 5 times as often as white children. And Hispanic children 8 times as often as whites. With more than half the country seeing an increase in hospitalizations and deaths, more states are imposing new restrictions. Hawaii closing Oahu beaches, Oregon limiting interstate travel, and Massachusetts cutting gathering sizes in half.
People are simply not being responsible about face coverings, social distancing, or any of the major metrics.
However, hundreds of thousands of bikers are converging on Sturgis, South Dakota for the city's annual motorcycle rally. Officials there promising when the rally ends next weekend, there will be mass testing available for residents. Across the country, as school districts look to reopen safely, they are grappling with tough decisions.
Well, I think about what if they're in an environment that they're exposed, and then, you know, what are the procedures?
The University of Washington releasing a dire projection, a possible death toll reaching nearly 300,000 by December, unless more people wear masks. Dr. Anthony Fauci is urging Americans to unify behind these basic health practices and is cautiously optimistic about a vaccine.
We could go into the fall and the winter coming out of it looking good.
Vaccine expert Dr. Paul Offit is on the FDA's advisory panel. He says testing procedures must be followed before any vaccine can be deemed safe.
If it's been tested in 20,000 people, shown to be safe, let's say it's 70, 75% effective at preventing this disease, preventing moderate to severe disease, keeping you out of the hospital, keeping you from dying, then I think the benefits clearly outweigh the risks.
A new Gallup poll released on Friday shows 65% of Americans would get a vaccine if it were FDA approved and free. But more than a third of those polled would not be willing to get vaccinated. Alex Brochet, ABC News, Washington.
And Colorado pilots are making sure airports across our state have enough personal protective equipment to stop the spread of coronavirus there. They're delivering 400,000 face masks to the state's rural airports this weekend. Angel Flight West is coordinating all of these flights. Their pilots have also been flying PPE to hospitals across the state.
It's been great for CABA, Colorado Aviation Business Association, to team up with them in this effort, using both our pilots and their pilots to meet this demand in a efficient time manner.
And FEMA donated all of these masks. They will be used by airport staff, pilots, and passengers at 30 airports across Colorado. Happening now, we are awaiting to hear from a local group of pastors. They are demanding the Aurora Police Department take action against officers they say wrongfully detained a black family this week. The Greater Metro Denver Ministerial Alliance wants the officers fired, and they say the mayor and the city council have 72 hours to comply. The group is saying if that doesn't happen, they will take action to have the mayor and city council recalled. District Attorney George Brockler is launching an investigation into the officers' actions to determine if criminal charges should be filed. This is the video showing the Aurora officers handcuffing and ordering the family to the ground. They pulled the family over thinking they were in a stolen car. They were not. Aurora's new police chief, Vanessa Wilson, says she has already launched an internal affairs investigation and is also cooperating with the DA's office. Turmoil surrounding the Colorado State football team. Allegations of racism and verbal abuse have put football activities on hold. Denver 7's Sean Toll reports on what players are now saying.
The week for the Colorado State football team started with a bombshell of allegations from a newspaper article.
There was a bomb that went off yesterday. That's kind of created a negative narrative.
The article claims CSU is altering contact tracing reports so players can continue training. A lack of mask wearing from head coach Steve Adazio to other coaches. Players saying they were told not to report symptoms and their playtime could be affected. The university announced an investigation into those allegations.
We're doing what everyone else in society is trying to do, and we're trying to manage this to the best of our ability. We're trying to move back to some level of normalcy, but we also understand that there's going to be setbacks and impacts that we can't anticipate, and we're fully ready to adjust to whatever those things are.
The claim that there was playing time being threatened, I haven't heard, no one's heard that, and I even checked with players on the team, like, yo, was I even sent in a meeting that I wasn't in?
Friday, the athletic director announced they were pausing football activities indefinitely amid allegations of racism and verbal abuse, with athletic director Joe Parker saying, quote, Colorado State University is committed to being an anti-racist university, and we will not tolerate any behavior or climate that goes against that core value. Football players called the allegations untrue in a statement released on social media Saturday. Their statement goes on to say they had not experienced any racially insensitive comments to their teammates from the athletic department or coaches. The players say they know the truth and are committed to the current coaching staff. Sean Toll, Denver 7.
And we'll stay on top of that story.